Hello, everybody. My name is Hisham El-Seedi, is a professor. And today, our lecture about pharmacognosy and the aim of this lecture that we are going to deal with some definitions about crude drug, primary metabolism, secondary metabolism, how much you are important as a pharmacognosist, not only from purely academic research, but also in connection with the society. So this is really important, as we will see. So when we talk about pharmacognosy, it is derived from Greek words, and it means pharmacog means a drug, and gnosis knowledge. So it is knowledge of drugs. And we are dealing with any drugs that comes from natural origin, like this plant material, for example. If we get a drug from this one, this means that it is pharmacognosy. So we do the extraction first to get the extract. Then this extract, if it showed activity and no toxicity at all, and if this is approved by the government based on the ethics, until you get a drug from this plant material like this one, this means it is pharmacognosy. So let us start with a rule of pharmacognosist, how much you are important. Number one, identification of crude drug material. How to identify this one till you get it as a drug? Assurance and the absence of any adulteration. Is there any adulteration? So we have to start with what is the plant material, for example. So everything must be documented from the beginning to get the plant material, identification by botanist, and to have an authentic sample. This means that absence of any adulteration. Also some details which we will study together. Diagnosis and dispensing of the appropriate regime for treatment. Also, since you are clinical pharmacy, this is very important for you. From this point of view, it comes as a definition of two points. What is pharmacognosy and what is the official drug? So pharmacognosy is a science dealing with the study of structure. What is the structure? What is the chemical compound? So we take the plant material starting as I showed you and get the crude drug. Then we try to isolate it to get it into fraction and finally to the pure compound. Then you get the structure of this pure compound at the end. So then you characterize the structure and see the biological activity. This also, you must consider the history. What is the history of this plant material? Is it really comes from the original place? What is the cultivation? How they cultivate it? Using standard international methods or not? What about collection and particularly treatment they receive during preparation for the market? So this is really very important points in order to have a safe drug. From this point of view, it comes as an official drug. So it is a drug listed and described in a book, recognized by government as a legal authority for standard this book. And it is termed pharmacopoeia. So pharmacopoeia, it means that you have passed by all this from starting of the identification of the plant material until you get the drug. If all of these steps based on scientific evidence and you give the scientific documents of every step, then the government will authorize this drug. And this is called pharmacopoeia. For details description of any crude, you should consider the following. What is the original? It means that the biological and geographical source. This you must know, or you give short note about the history of the name of the drug. It comes cultivation and preparation. So where this plant has been cultivated, how they collect the part used, how they make drying and packing. All these are important factors to have a safe drug for treatment of crude drug in the course from biological source to the market. This This constituents and the testis, adulteration, isolation, etc., we will study it one by one in the following slides. And before we start, I will give you a picture from the old time and the modern one, which deals with all this story. So this is very important figure, which is possible for application. So we start with any organism, like I have shown you. Then you go to, after identification, you go for separation and identification, like this one. You start with the corrode drug. Then you go to first for separation, further separation, till you get pure compound. So this means separation and identification, which is by spectroscopy. Then you get the chemical structure. So the first important for you as a pharmacognosist to get the chemical structure. After that, of course, you combine this with biological activity to see what is the activity. For example, it has cancer activity, but on the other hand, also to see the cytotoxicity, the toxicity effect. Then this one could be go to drugs or herbal drug, like this example, for example. So they go from the plant material until they get the crude drug. And further, you can study also the model precursor tool. So this is the old figure, which it showed you the whole story of the work in pharmacognosy. And what is the goal of this application? Why we do that? And why it is really very important? Look to the corona now. They are really struggling and working very hard. And it is global, international. It is international problem all over the world. They would like to find a new drug. So this is how much you are important. So it is to find the lead structure for development of new drug. So this is the goal of application. With bioassay guided isolation. So for every step, you follow it by biological activity. And I have explained this in another literature. Also, you use high throughput screening as a fast technique in order to screen as many as possible of plant material, as well as of compounds to get the targeted drug lead. Look to some statisticals, how much it is important. So the selection of organism was based on traditional medicine. So we start with getting a plant material, like any of these plants, by asking the herbal medicine. So we go to the Bedouins or people living with plants and ask about their experience, which plant could be used for cancer, for example. So we started with this traditional medicine. And the strategy was very successful. They looked to this, some statisticals. 28% of chemical entities are coming from natural products. So by statisticals, this is very important to deal with natural products. And this explains you why Arabic region, for example, and Latin America is very rich in flora. Number two, 34% totally senses. It comes from synthetic chemistry. While 12% were senses, but with natural product as a starting material. So if you count 12% and 28%, it means 40% drugs comes from natural products. And why we use high throughput screening? This is a fast technique which you can screen a lot of extracts and compounds in an automated fashion. And this will give you the chance to get an active compound as early as possible. So this figure has been modified more in recent times, just last year, by these authors, as you can see. And they had been modified it with modern technique. And especially this is important for young generation, because you are very good also in computer and you like to work more in the computer. So if you combine doing the lab work, which is by old fashioned way, with the modern technique, then you can reach to potent active compound in much faster way than 20 years ago. How we can do that? Look here, it is the same before organism. this must be to get chemical structure, and this should be in connection with biological activity. And how you do that? By observation or selection. This is why you deal with traditional healers. Till you get chemical structure. Then you use the modern technique, like chemoinformatics, for example, system biology, etc., in order to get data. This you can combine it with phylogenetic studies as well. Then you can really adopt it with drug discovery in much effective way, and also in fast way, which is really needed, not only because of corona, but because also of other diseases which the world is suffering from regarding cardiovascular, anti-cancer, etc. And this should be also combined with in vivo and in vitro studies in order to see the bioactivity. That's why we say the previously described field of chemoinformatics, phylogenetic, system biology, all these new techniques has been developed since previous model. That's why we have new edition of this book of pharmacognosy. Then you go to classification of drugs. How they classify the drug in according to alphabetical or taxonomic or pharmacological or morphological or chemical structures. So this is the way how they classify the drugs. What about the origin of drugs? It can be biological or geographical or commercial. Look to biological origin, for example, natural origin. This is a system of classification applied for the biological origin of crude drug, either botanical origin of a plant material or the zoological origin of animal. So we have to know what is the original of this material. Then it comes to the nomenclature of crude drug of plant origin. This must be by bioanimal name, naming the plant material. So we call the plant is genus and species, as we will see in the next example. So for example, this plant, if you say the two words and it is in italic, it means it is a species. If you say only the first word, this means it is the genus. If you call it by geographical source, so this is called Luffea egyptiaca. It means the original source is Egypt. So this is the way of the specific name are naturally chosen to indicate some striking characteristics of the plant. So this is a restriction for choosing the plant material. Or if it is by characteristic color, this means that it is rosemary, for example. If it is aromatic plant, then it is this species. If it is by active constituent, it means a compound is very active, then you choose it this way. Or by special indicator, or after a person, for example, if a person make really an important rule. And then finally, it is according to important morphological characteristics. Look to the geographical origin, for example. So this is the knowledge of geographical source which help in identification of the biological origin, because some plants grow in certain areas which is different according to the climate, etc. Right? It is also important to note that the habitat effect not only affects the constituents, but also the medical uses. And this is as an example about herbs. So that's why, for example, in Saudi Arabia, it is very famous of dates, for example, in Medina especially, which is called Agwa. So this is a typical example about geographical origin of the plant material. Commercial origin. So this is according to the commercial. It refers to the place of drug production or transport. And this, of course, dealing with money. So money affect a lot. And it also depending on the native country. That's why we have to be careful about the origin. And this we call it, if something is wrong, we call it adulteration. And it is you as a pharmacognosist who discover that. Then it comes to the production of crude drug. So it is cultivation. We talked about it. Then we go to the second one. Again, cultivation, sorry. So the cultivation It can be also wild plant, which it means that, or it is cultivated plant. So plant is grown in native land by indigenous people, for example, while those cultivated, it's called as naturalized. So this is wild plant, which means that it comes from nature, and this is cultivated, which means that we specify an area and then we grow certain plants. So this is comes from nature and this is comes from cultivation. And what about this? What is the difference between both of them? So there is a difference. So wild plant is found in wide distributions, unlimited areas, and continuous extensive collection lead to this plant material. And it is collected amount of this wild plant may be insufficient for the market. So this is some advantage. What is the disadvantage really? So this is the disadvantage of the wild plant material. It is also difficulty in collection and transportation because they are mostly growing in deserts, etc. Adulteration because of collection. So it means that for the wild plant material, you can control all the disadvantages because you can have it in a specific area. So we'll take it as advantage of cultivation of medicinal plants. It means that concentration of a large number in a small area, therefore simplifying collection, control the purity of the product. We are sure about the product. Also, the cultivation has irregular and constant supply. It means that you guarantee that you get the amount you needed. This is important for controlling certain factors of cultivation. And it is also treatment of seeds before growing it to ensure germination. So all these are advantage. Also, we use fertilization, which can provide the cultivated plants with certain essential elements like sodium, potassium, nitrogen, phosphorus, etc. We use also certain instances and pesticides help to control this insect treatment. This is very important also to control the plant material regarding pesticides. So all these are advantages. But what is the disadvantages of this cultivation of medicinal plants? It is the costs. Of course, the costs will be high. Second, some medicinal plants require the particular habits, for example. This will be difficult to cultivate. What about collection of medicinal plants? So when you collect a medicinal plant, this is very important. Why? Because the qualitative and the quantitative composition may show variation according to growing season, time of the day, and the stage of maturity. So these are three factors affect the collection of plants. To ensure that you have really the right plant material and to get the right root drug, you have to use proper stage of development. Why? Because the active constituent. And please underline this active constituent. This is very important because the active constituent is the main factor which affects on the therapeutic effect as well as the side effects as well. That's why we have to be sure about certain origin or specific tissues of these organs. So what about these factors in detail, for example, the time of the year? So the active constituent, this active compound, which you get it in the final step, for example, so this active constituent may vary qualitatively and quantitatively during the year. And how to know that? By studying the scientific evidence in the lab. Also, the time of the day, it could affect the active constituents, like this example. Also, about the stage, the active, it affects as well. So we have to be careful about this. And these are some examples it's shown. What about drying of crude drugs? The drying material, when you have the plant material, of course, when it is in fresh, it is about 80 to 90% moisture. So how to dry it? And is this could affect the active constituent? Yes. Why? Because this is the importance of drying. Number one, it stops the enzyme enzymatic reaction, enzymatic actions. It means that affect the active constituent. So all the time for you as a pharmacognosist is active compound. Number two, it can also make deterioration, which it caused microbial contamination. This means that if you make drying of this plant material in wrong way, it will affect and it make microbial contamination. This will be dangerous for the people. Also facilitating packing, storage, etc. and the transportation, you have to be careful, and this affects the costs. The drying is also to fulfill pharmacopoeial requirements. As we study in the second slide, the pharmacopoeia who authorized the drug must be sure about all these steps. This is just an example to show you in the picture how this plant material, it is dry, but it is still in the same shape. It means it has been done in proper way. Like this, which I showed you before. This plant material, you see, it has been dried in the optimum way. And still you can see the plant very clearly. Backing of the crude drug. It is important also to make the backing in proper way. So backing provided protection against dust, against microorganisms, insects, etc. It is also economic if you make it in using the right space during storage. What about the storage of crude drug? The crude drug are gradually deteriorate if they are stored under any uncontrolled condition. If this crude drug, which you get, and if you store it in not in the proper way, it affects the active constituents as well. So what is the general rules for that? The aromatic drugs usually lose their aroma. So if it is aromatic drug, it will affect. Also drugs containing fixed oil, this will affect a lot, because as you know, the volatile oil affected by storage, and also the biological activity affect as well in this point. For these reasons, pharmacopoeia clear instructions in the storage of crude drug, they may be stored in well-closed container, this is a precautions, protected from light at lower temperature and from insects as well. This is just an example of natural origin about bee bread. You see, it has been done according to all the rules until you get it as a drug. And this is an example which it showed recent insights into chemical and pharmacological studies of bee bread, which published in Trends in Food Science and Technology. So this is international journal with impact factor about 8.5. It shows you about all these conditions. From this point of view, we can go to primary metabolism and secondary metabolism. What is the role of this in drug discovery? So if we start with primary metabolism, it represented the products which are fatal for living organism. It's very important or fatal. And it is kind of metabolite that is directly involved in normal growth. It means it is very important. If you stop this primary metabolism, you will not end up with any drug from this plant origin or any natural origin. It usually performs a physiological function in the organism. So this is typical example of what we are saying. So this guy, we call it ethnopharmacology. It means that he knows about these plant materials by experience from his grandfather and the father and living with plants. So he knew by heart what is the plant effective, for example, as anti-cancer. That's why this Swedish delegation come to visit this guy. It means he is extremely important. Otherwise, why they should pay a trip from Sweden to come to Egypt and then 1,000 kilometers to go to Sinai to meet him. It means his knowledge in his head is very important. And this is how we start to work and to choose plant material. So we choose this plant according to his knowledge. From this, we can say about primary metabolism, which goes to secondary. Like, for example, amino acid, it is a unit of protein, while fatty acid is a phospholipid. This carbohydrate with glycerol, it gives phospholipid, while the monosaccharide, it gives polysaccharides. And nucleobases, it gives two nucleotides, then DNA and RNA. So these are examples of primary metabolism. And secondary metabolism, this is important in drug discovery. It is the organic compound, which it is in the final, like this one, involved directly in the life cell. And this important role in plant defense, so it cannot be only drug, like what I have shown you, but it can be used in any other purpose, like it plant defense. It is also can be used in flavoring, in food, etc. And the examples is different classes like phenyl, propanoids, polyketides, terpenoids, steroids, alkaloids, flavonoids, steroids, coumarins, xanthones, etc. So all these are classes of natural products. And how much it is important? Look to this example. It contains volatile compound, limonene, which it comes from lemon. And this is important. It is also healthy, and it is good to remove the toxic. It is good for the face, etc. That's why if you drink lemon, it's very good for your healthy, comparing to you drink another synthetic drinks. So this is your rule, and this is your reaction to the society. So if you drink lemon, you get this limonene, which is very good for you. Also, flavoring, it is also used in perfumes, as you know, like this example, and it is famous in these countries, like rose oil. This is very famous. What about adulteration in pharmacognosy or natural products? This is very important. How we can know that it is true? It is no substitution. They didn't make admixture, deterioration, spoilage. So these are main factors of adulteration. So the first one is sophistication or true adulteration. So if you have the plant material as it is, like this one, and you have it, you know the original of it, and you don't add anything to it, and you keep all the procedures who are talking about it, it means it is the best. So, but if you add any other compounds or any other materials or contaminated with any materials, then we call it adulteration. So this is an example. Is if you have, for example, powdered of vinegar with enough capsaicin, this will affect or enhance, and it will affect also in the color. Or substitution. If you replaced the original drug by another, this is a criminal. And you make this substitution, why? Because of the money. Like, for example, this examples here, it showed you different of this substitution. And who can discover that? It is you as a pharmacognosist or natural product. What about admixture? It is addition of one article to another. It can be by accident, or it can be by ignorance, any of these, or it can be in purpose because of the money. So if you make it as admixture, it will affect. The third, deterioration, can be defined as important of the quality of the drug by substitution or destruction of valuable constituent by distillation, extraction, etc. This could affect as well the active constituents, or spoilage, a form of deterioration, which is how it comes is this. If you destroy this by any fungi, by action of fungi mainly, This will affect about the drug discovery or the active constituents. So this is a picture which it shows you the adulteration. So this is the original drug and this is adulteration. So you can see the difference. Or this is the original and this is the adulteration. So you see how much is the difference. So the normal people couldn't identify such adulteration is you as a pharmacognosist. I will give you an example about this and how you can deal with the society, how you can solve the problem. Look to this onion and the garlic. This is application. So if you eat onion and garlic, it's very good for diabetes. It is very good for heart diseases. It's very good of obesity, hypertension, anti-cancer. How many of you eat onion and garlic as a fresh with salad or something? This means that you get all this. It's very good as antibiotic. So look to this problem. Some people eat it as naturally, and this is the scientific evidence. If you eat it as naturally, and then you identify the volatile compound by GC-MS, or non-volatile compound by LC-MS and NMR, then you get 42 and 51 compounds, which is very good for you as antibiotic, for example. What about if you take it as a tablet? It is no antimicrobial effect at all. Additionally, you have another compound. So this is what we call it, the scientific evidence to approve why we must eat this as a natural, and we have to be careful and study what you have it in the market. Second, what is the chemistry of the crude drug? From this, we have been already seen that the primary metabolism examples like starch, amino acid, proteins, or secondary metabolism, which is the other classes of natural product. So starch is the unit of glucose, as you know, and if it connected together, you end up with starch. And what about this? This is the unit of primary metabolism. And this is amylose. And if it is substituted this way, it is amylopectin. And this is 80% and 20% respectively. And this is primary metabolism. What is the special test? It's very easy if you do it with iodine. What about the uses of starch? It is skin. It also affect in this way. What about proteins? The protein is amino acid connected together, and this amino acid connected by peptide bond to give a high molecular weight compound. So this is the second. And this is an example how we get polypeptides, which we showed from cactus species. So usually use an examples in order to get the knowledge. And what about oils? Oils, as you know, like olive oil, this is natural. So they are esters of long chain fatty acid of high molecular weight if reacted with glycerol. And their consistency either solids or liquids, like this example, stearic oleic acids. In plants, you have, for example, olive oil. So this is very healthy, as you know, olive oil. And it has been mentioned in Holy Quran as well. What about the volatile oil? It is usually a mixture of many compounds, and usually they are hydrocarbon, sometimes with oxygen. That's why we say the volatile oil is usually monoterpene and sesquiterpenes. And this is an example about oil. And you know, it uses as flavoring agent, and it is also has effect in many diseases. This is as examples. You look to this compound. If you count this, you will end up with C10. And it is hydrocarbon. Immediately you say this is monoterpene, because it contains two units of isoprene, C5H8, two units, it means C10H16 if you count. And this is acyclic monoterpene, while this is a cyclic terpene. What about these characteristic oils? It is oils, fats. It is insoluble in water and alcohol, except oil. Some is soluble in alcohol. It is soluble in ether, chloroform, and petroleum ether because they are non-polar. That's why it's important to know such information. If you mix oil with water, it is insoluble. But if you add petroleum ether, chloroform, of course it is soluble. And it is easily saponified by aqueous potassium hydroxide. This is how you get soup. And you can get also natural soup, and it is expensive than the other soup. Uses of fixed oil. We use it in nutrition. We use it as pharmaceutically. We use it for preparation of soup and emulsion, etc. What about secondary metabolism? We will take an example like of this shape. It is brismis. This is just one slide to show you about the morphology, which you can see under the microscope. Then you will see this shape with brismis cluster, etc. What about secondary metabolism? If we take this as an example, it contains tannins. And what is tannin? It is phenolic compound. Benzene ring with OH, it means phenolic. This is number one. And it is usually high molecular weight. Why? Because the unit of tannin, it connected with the protein to prevent its their putrefaction when they convert it to leather. That's why the natural leather is very expensive. And the tannins are high molecular weight. This is an example of tannin. It is galatannin or elagatannin. Galatannin, it means gallic acid. So this is the unit of gallic acid with sugar. And the elagatannin, it means two units of gallic acid connected together. It means elagic acid connected with tannins. While complex tannins is mixture between both with sugar unit. And the condensed tannins is flavonoid and the condensed or repeated again. Tannins are classified into two main groups, hydrolyzable tannins and condensed tannins, as we have seen, and this is the effect. What about alkaloid? In very simple way, alkaloid is nitrogen compound, and that's why we call it alkali, and usually they are organic, of course, and it has crystalline substances. And usually the alkaloids have physiological function, like this example as well. Then we go to the glycoside. In very simple way, glycoside means sugar unit attached to any organic compound. Like in this case, it is a steroid. Four-membered ring with five-membered ring. That's why we call this glycoside in total. If we take this part only, we call it aglycone or steroid. And this part, we call it sugar or glucone. And this could be hydrolyzed by enzyme or by acid. So you have to know the structure of glycoside in very simple way. Glycosides means sugar attached to organic compound. And this is another example of phenolic glycoside. For example, this structure is glycosides. Again, this is glycoside. Again, this is glycoside. So all these compounds are glycosides, because it connected with sugar unit. And this is, as usual, one example to show you about traditional medical uses and cytotoxic activity of 61 Egyptian plantes. Why I say Egyptian plantes? In order to follow the rules I had been explained, that we must know the origin of this plant and we must keep the right for the country. Second, discovery of active cardiac glycoside. It means the active constituent. So you must know the active compound and you must specify the plant. And here we put Ahmed Mansour, while he is not in academic research. He is just a Saint Catherine. The Bedouin man, I showed you the picture. Why we put him in the paper? Because he gave you the knowledge about traditional uses. So this is a typical example which showed you all this story, from starting of the plant material until you get the active constituent. So we take the plant material like this one, 61, and then we take the plants which recommended and see what is the scientific evidence. Then we found out he is correct. So this plant showed activity, and then we isolated the active compound in the final. So this is the scientific evidence. And this showed you how we must work as a team. Pharmacognosy, natural product, and botany to identify the plant material. These are botanists. And ethnopharmacology, about uses of plants in traditional medicine, pharmacology, and the medical doctor as well. So this is the teamwork which can lead to success and which can really study the plants in the perfect way. And this is the active compound. And this is the activity in vitro studies, which I have mentioned. And this is the species to show the picture. So the biological activity is very important. And this is the references of this literature. So I will give a short conclusion in Arabic about my literature. المحاضرة دي يا حضرات بتوري حضراتكو إزاي أنتوا مهمين في كفارماكوجنسيست. أنتوا ليه مهمين؟ عشان أنتوا اللي بتشوفوا النبات من ساعة إما يبقى في بداية بتاعته خالص من بداية زراعته لغاية ما يوصل إلى دراج. أي خطأ يحصل في السكة دي كلها اللي يكشف الغش ده هو حضرتك كفارماكوجنسيست. وهي دي أهميتك، مش بس كأهمية علمية، أهميتك للمجتمع، لأن إذا حضرتك صحتك كويسة خلاص كل حاجة تمشي سليمة. ومن هنا جه تعريف الكرود دراج، اللي هو أن أنت تاخد البلانت ماتيريال اللي هي ديت وتعمل عليها إكستراكشن، يديك الإكستراكت من غير ما تفصل مكوناته. لو ثبت أن له فعالية وملوش أضرار جانبية يبقى ده خلاص بقى كرود دراج وتقدر تستخدمه. طب لو عايز تخليه بقى فعال قوي، يعني يجيب تأثير قوي، يبقى لازم تتتبع الخطوات لحد ما توصل للمادة الفعالة. ولما توصل للمادة الفعالة يقوم يبقى تأثيره أقوى. وده يجاوب لك هل صح إن أنا أروح أشتري أعشاب طبية من العطار واستخدمها بدون دراسة علمية؟ أنت تقدر تجاوب السؤال ده؟ طبعا يبقى غلط جدا. ليه؟ لأن أنت فين الساينتيفيك إيفيدنس اللي هي احنا اتكلمنا عليها؟ ان هل النبات اتعرف صح من البدايه؟ هل في بوتاني عرفه زي ما قلنا في البيبر؟ هل اتكلمت مع العشاب وشفتها؟ هل رحت عملت اكستراكشن وطلعت الماده الفعاله ككيمستري وفارماكولوجي؟ هل شفت التاثير؟ هل له تاثير سميه؟ وايه الجرعه المناسبه لي؟ اذا انت عملت كل الحاجات دي يبقى انا اقدر استخدم النبات ده امنا. ومن هنا جت الفارماكوبية. يبقى تعريف الفارماكوبية هو إيه؟ إن الحكومة تصرح لي بالدواء ده وتنزله بناء على كل الدراسات دي. إذا كل الدراسات اللي احنا قلنا عليها من بداية تعريف النبات بعد كده زرعته، هل زرعته تمت في بيئة صحيحة وتروى بمية وبدون ملوثات بيئية؟ طيب لما جم يحصدوه هل حصدوه في الوقت المناسب اللي ما أثرش على المادة الفعالة؟ وهل ما ضافولوشي نباتات تانية؟ لأن لما هتنضاف وتنطحن مع بعضيها هيبقى كلها لون واحد. هو ده اللي بنقول عليه الأدولتريشن اللي هو الغش. يبقى لو غش في أي خطوة من دول بسبب الربح مين اللي هيكشفها؟ حضرتك كفارماكوجنسيست. وهي دي أهميتك زي ما احنا بنقول. طب لو النبات اكتمل نموه لحد الآخر خالص أسميه سكندري ميتابوليزم. طب النبات في البداية بسميه برايمري ميتابوليزم. يبقى دي التعريفات اللي احنا قلناها. طب الخريطة اديتك خريطتين اتنين، الخريطة القديمة والخريطة الجديدة، دول بيوضحوا لك. دي الخريطة القديمة بتوضح لك ايه مدى الفريق العمل وان انتوا تتعاونوا مع بعض، واديتك بيانات هنا احصائية على ازاي ان هو الناتشرال برودكت مهمة. لو جمعت ال 28 و12% يبقى 40% من الدواء جاي من النباتات. ومن هنا تيجي اهمية بلادنا في العالم العربي والعالم الإسلامي ولاتين أمريكا والصين طبعا، بينما أوروبا عندها نقص في النباتات الطبية عشان الجو مختلف. تمام يا حضرات؟ ودي الصورة الحديثة اللي هي فيها استخدام البيانات الحديثة اللي هي الكيمو انفورماتيكس والسيستم بيولوجي والفيلوجيناتيك ستاديز عشان يوريك إيه. يبقى أنت هنا في سنة 2019 وشفت قد إيه أن أنا محترمك كطالب لأني مديك معلومات من سنة 2019. اللي هو تحديث للتاني، عشان كده ضفنا عليه. يبقى انت لو استخدمت الداتابيز بالكمبيوتر، وانتوا الجيل الحديث كمان وجيل الشباب اللي هو المستقبل، اللي هم اهم ناس، اللي هم هيطلعوا افضل مننا، لو استخدموا الحاجات الحديثه دي تقدر توصل لدراج ديسكفري اسرع بكتير من اللي فات ده. مفهوم يا حضرات؟ يبقى طيب ايه الكلاسيفيكيشن اوف دراج؟ قسموها طبقا للفيجر اللي قدام حضرتك دي. طب ايه العوامل اللي بتاثر عندي؟ هنا فيه ريستريكشن، دي حاجة مهمة جدا. ليه هنبقى ريستريكت لاسم النبات؟ يبقى ريستريكت لاسم النبات يا إما تبع المنطقة زي النبات، أو تبع الكالر الشكل بتاعه، أو تبع الأروماتيستي. يبقى دي الريستريكشن بتاع النبات، ودي كتير بتيجي سؤال في الفارماكوجنسي. وهنا وريك بقى الجيوغرافيكال ريجون والكوميرشال ريجون. مثلا يجي يقول لك دي عجوه من السعوديه من المدينه المنوره، تبقى غاليه جدا. طب مين يثبت انها كده؟ يبقى لازم انت دورك كفارماكوجنوسيست، ده بيوضح لك الجيوغرافيكال والكوميرشال بتاعتها. طيب هنا اتكلم لك على الكالتيفيشن، ايه ميزه اللي مزروع وايه ميزه اللي مش مزروع. يبقى اللي مش مزروع اهوت واللي مزروع اهوت، اداك المميزات بتاع المزروع والعيوب بتاعتها هي ايه. تمام، من العيوب المميزات بتاعتها طبعا بتحصل على كميات كبيره ومضمونه ويتكفي السوق. طب العيوب ايه؟ انها ممكن تبقى فيري كوستلي. ومن هنا يجي الناس اللي عايزه تشتغل بيزنس، يبقى هنا شغل البيزنس اللي انت اتعلمته من خلال الفارماكوجنسي تقدر تجيب انبوت هنا. عشان كده انا بناشد الشباب انه يتعلم بغض النظر يكمل بحث علمي او يروح يبقى رجل اعمال، لكن لو بقيت رجل اعمال عن علم هو ده اللي هيفيدك ويفيد المجتمع. كمان لما تيجي تجمع النباتات اتكلمنا عليها، لازم الوقت يبقى الوقت الصح والتايم وخطواتها، ودي كلها تكون ما تاثرش على المواد الفعاله، وادي الشكل اللي بيبين لك ان النباتات دي اتجمعت بصوره صحيحه. طب لما تيجي تعمل لها باكينج، تعبيها في صناديق، لازم تعبيها في صناديق محكمه. ليه؟ لو ديت اتلوثت باي ميكروب او اي مايكرو اورجانيزمس هتديك طبعا مشاكل كتيره جدا وتاثر على الصحه. هي ديت الجزئيه المهمه. واديتك مثال اهوت على البي بريد، وادي البحث اللي منشور عليه، وبعدين اتكلمنا بقى على البرايمري ميتابوليزم، بقيتوا عارفينها كويس، اللي هي الخطوات الاوليه اللي هي مهمه لنمو النبات، لا غنى للنبات عنها. لو انت وقفتها خلاص مش هتحصل على سكندري ميتابولايتس. وادي الامثله عليها الاربعه. طب السكندري ميتابوليزم، لا، المركبات اللي نتجت بقى اللي انت خلاص بتستخدمها زي الليمون ده، انت بتشرب كده سكندري ميتابوليزم. طب ليه الليمون مهم لنضاره الوجه؟ عشان فيه الليمونين وبيطرد السموم، وده ميزته على انك انت تشرب مشروبات صناعيه. يبقى دي مره ثانيه هيدي الانتر اكشن مع السوسايتي. شايفين دور حضرتك ازاي؟ طيب بتستخدمها كمان ايه في 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 العطور؟ لما تبقى عطور طبيعيه ليه بتبقى فيري اكسبنسيف عن الصناعيه؟ لان برضه ملهاش اي سايد افكت، ريحتها بتبقى جميله، بتقعد وقت اطول كده. انت تبقى فاهم وانت في حتى في الماركت ليه ده اغلى وليه ده ارخص. هنا بقى بيوريك الغش اللي هي النقطه بتاعت شغلك. هل يا ترى حصل غش؟ ازاي يحصل الغش؟ هل ضفت مادة؟ هل استبدلت مادة بمادة؟ هل ادي أمثلة ليها هي يوريك الشكل ايه؟ هل حصل سبويلج؟ يعني الصلاحية خلصت، أو حصل أي انزيماتيك أثرت، أو أي انسكتس أو أي فانجاي اتكونت في البلانت ماتيريال؟ ده كله هيأثر عليك. وأدي أمثلة على الأدلتريشن، أدي الأوريجينال وأدي الأدلتريشن، أدي الأوريجينال وأدي الأدلتريشن. مثال على كده البصل والثوم، لو أنت كلته طبيعي هيفيدك في الدايابيتيك والكانسر والأوبيسيتي والهايبرتينشن، كل دي فوائد ليه. طب لو أخدت التوم الصناعي مفيش ولا إفكت ليه، ده ممكن يضر جسمك. شفت بقى مدى أهمية حضرتك؟ بعد كده دخلنا رجعنا تاني على البرايمري ميتابوليزم، أمثلة عليه اللي هي ديت، وبعدين دخلنا على السكندري ميتابوليزم، وقلنا الفولاتايل اويلز صفاتها ايه، وانت درستها كمان في البايوكيمستري. ادي امثله هي على المونوتيربينويد اللي هي فولاتايل اويل، وليه سميتها مونوتيربينويد زي ما حضرتك شايف كده، وايه الصفات بتاعتها وايه فايدتها. وكذلك حتى بتدخل في صناعه الصابون الطبيعي، وادي امثله تاني بيوريك المورفولوجي اللي هو تحت الميكروسكوب. اخذت مثال واحد عشان تعرف ايه معنى مورفولوجي وايه معنى الاجزاء اللي بشوفها تحت الميكروسكوب ده بالاشكال دي. طيب بعد كده دخلنا على كلاس التنين. التنين دي جالا تنين زي الجاليك اسيد اهو، اتدرب على الاستراكشر ده. الشوجر اسمها باي طريقه تعجبك. طب اللاجيك اسيد يعني ايه؟ 2 يونت من الجاليك اسيد متوصلين ببعض يبقى اللاجيك اسيد. وادي فائده التنين والالكالويد، مركبات الالكالويد مركبات عضويه بيبقى فيها نيتروجين اتوم واحده او اكتر ولها فارماكولوجيكال اكتيفيتي. بعد كده دخلنا على الجلايكوزايدز. ادي الجلايكوزايد اهوت وشابك في استيرويد على بعضه كده نسميه استيرويد جلايكوزايد. طب لو فصلنا ده عن بعضه، لو كسرناه عن طريق اسيد او انزيم يبقى ده استيرويد او اجليكون، ويبقى ده شوجر او جلوكون. هي دي التسمية، ودي طبعا مهمة جدا ليك انك تعرف التسميات دي. بعد كده اخذنا امثلة تانية على الجلايكوزايد. يبقى اي حاجة من الشوجر مشتركة مع اورجانيك كومباوند نسميها جلايكوزايد. وادى مثال اهوت بيعرفك بقى ايه دور احمد منصور. ادي فريق العمل، يبقى العشاب حتى اللي جمع واداك معلومات اللي هو من سانت كاترين تحطه على البيبر، والكيمستري تحطه على البيبر، والفارماكولوجي تحطه على البيبر، والميديكال. يبقى ده تيبيكال اكزامبل يوريك كل القصة من البداية على أساس علمي. يبقى لما النبات ده كده درسته، درست عرفت المصدر ليه ايه. ادي فايدة المثال التطبيقي يا حضرات، ان لازم تاخد مثال واثنين وتلاتة عشان تقدر تطبق كل القواعد من اول جزئية لحد اخر شيء. يبقى البلانت اوريجين ايجيبشن. طيب البوتاني عرف لي النبات صح، يبقى مفيش غلط. طيب بعد كده التراديشنال يوزز بيستخدم في الطب الشعبي احمد منصور. طب ايه الماده الفعاله؟ يبقى هنا ده مع الفارماكولوجي بيشتغلوا مع بعض. وادي الميديكال دكتور، وهكذا يا حضرات. اعتقد هي ديت فايده المثال. طب ايه اللي حصل؟ ادي النباتات اتيت اللي احنا درسناها، وادي الاكتيفيتي لحد ما وصلنا للماده الفعاله اللي موجوده عندي. اختار حضرتك اي مثال من اي بيبر وحط البيبر عشان تحفظ حقوق الناس. طب لو ما حطيتش الاسامي المؤلفين وكده يبقى دي سرقه بحثيه ويبقى كده غلط عليك. يبقى لما بتكتب مقال لازم تحط المصدر اللي انت جبت منه. وادي الماده الفعاله اللي طلعت والتاثير البيولوجي ليها. شكرا على حسن استماعكم. Thank you very much and I wish you all the very best. I hope you enjoyed my lecture.